Guten Abend. Guten Abend. Herzlich willkommen zu unserem heutigen Künstlervortrag. Besonders willkommen heißen möchte ich Mischka Henner, der heute aus Manchester gekommen ist und uns die Freude macht, heute über seine Arbeit zu reden. Mischka Henner ist einer der Fotografen, einer der Künstler, die wir oben in unserer Ausstellung Fotografie heute, Distant Realities, zeigen. Eine Ausstellungsreihe, die im zweijährigen Abstand neuen Tendenzen innerhalb der Fotografie nachgeht und vor allem der Frage, wie die Digitalität, die Digitalisierung und die Virtualisierung auch das Medium Fotografie vor allem in der künstlerischen Anwendung verändert hat. Ich darf Ihnen kurz Mischka Henner vorstellen. Er wurde 1976 in Belgien geboren und ist dann in den 80er Jahren nach England gegangen, wo er auch heute noch lebt. Er hat eine Ausbildung am Goldsmiths College, unter anderem am Goldsmiths College in London gemacht und sich intensiv mit Soziologie beschäftigt, auch das studiert. Und für seine künstlerische Entwicklung war die Begegnung mit dem Werk von Stephen Shore, von William Eggleston, von Robert Adams wichtig. Künstlern, Fotografen, die in 2003 in London in einer großen Ausstellung präsentiert wurden und die in der amerikanischen Fotografie für die Bewegung im weitesten Sinne des New Topographic stehen. Das heißt, es sind künstlerische Positionen, die sich vor allem in Amerika gebildet haben, die in den späten 60er und dann vor allem in den 70er Jahren sich mit dem Thema der Landschaft auseinandergesetzt haben. Sie wissen, dass die amerikanische Fotografie eine ganz große Tradition der Landschaftsdarstellung hat, vor allem für das 19. Jahrhundert, wo man die Landschaften des Mittleren Westens und der Westküste neu gefunden hat und von dieser unberührten königlichen Landschaft berauscht war und das in einer Vielzahl von Fotografien dokumentiert hat. Es ist eine Vorstellung der amerikanischen Landschaft, die uns eigentlich bis heute ein Stück weit begleitet, die aber mit der Realität der Landschaft nichts mehr zu tun hat. Und das ist das Thema der Fotografen aus den 60er und 70er Jahren, die eben versuchen, in einem sehr analytischen, einem dokumentarischen Stil diese Landschaft, so wie sie ist, darzustellen. Sie finden einige dieser Beispiele in unserer Sammlungspräsentation Outskirts. Sie ist oben in Saal 28 zu sehen und die Ausstellung Fotografie heute in Saal 21. Die Ausstellung endet am 29. Januar, also am Ende dieses Monats. Mischka Henner, und das ist auch der Grund, warum wir ihn für unsere Ausstellung ausgesucht haben, ist ein Künstler, der dann angefangen hat, vor allem mit Bildmaterial zu arbeiten, das er dem Internet entnommen hat, unter anderem Google Street View. Er ist also ein Künstler, der sich Bildmaterial von anderen aneignet, aber nicht unbedingt von anderen Künstlern, auch das geschieht, das würde uns gleich vorstellen, sondern vor allem von jenen Sehmaschinen, die in zunehmendem Maße unsere virtuelle Welt und auch unsere Wahrnehmung bestimmen. Und wie er damit umgeht und welche Projekte er entwickelt hat in den letzten fast 15 Jahren, wird er uns gleich in seinem Vortrag vorstellen. Er ist in einer Vielzahl musealer Sammlungen international vertreten. Er wurde 2013 mit dem Infinity Award of Art vom International Center of Photography in New York ausgezeichnet. Er war nominiert für den Deutsche Börse Photography Preis, einer der wichtigsten europäischen Fotopreise, wie auch für den Prix Pictet und ist in einer Vielzahl von Gruppenausstellungen und Einzelausstellungen vertreten, die in den letzten Jahren stattgefunden haben, vor allem eben zum Thema digitaler Kunst, Internetkunst, Seemaschinen und dem Thema der Überwachung wie des Voyeurismus in gleicher Weise. Er setzt sich, und auch das werden Sie gleich an seinen Arbeiten sehen, sehr intensiv mit Fotogeschichte, mit fotohistorischen Traditionen auseinander und damit, was ist eine Fotografie, was war sie, was ist sie und wie gehen wir heute mit diesem Erbe, wie geht er heute mit diesem Erbe als Künstler um. Er wird uns seine Arbeit jetzt vorstellen und im Anschluss daran würde ich mich sehr freuen, wenn Sie Lust und Interesse hätten, mit einigen Fragen sich an der Diskussion zu beteiligen. Bevor ich schließe, würde ich Sie gerne noch darauf hinweisen, dass wir nächsten Donnerstag noch einmal im Rahmen unserer Serie Reset Talks eine Diskussionsveranstaltung haben, und zwar zum Thema ganz explizit der NS-Kunst. Sie wissen, das ist gerade ein sehr aktuelles Thema, was immer wieder durch den Medien geht. Wie gehen wir mit dieser Kunst um? Wie geht das Museum damit um? Wie geht sie mit uns um? Das wird nächste Woche ein Thema dieser Podiumsdiskussion sein. Das Faltblatt hierzu liegt aus. Und für alle von Ihnen, die sich für die Fotografie in unserem Haus interessieren, möchte ich Sie Ihnen sehr ans Herzen legen, die ganz exzellente Ausstellung zu den Ruhrgebietslandschaften von Albert Renger-Pratsch, ein Schatz, den wir hier mit der Stiftung Wilde an unser Haus bringen konnten, und eine Ausstellung, die Sie jetzt noch bis Ende April sehen können. Ebenso oben unsere Sammlung, eine Ausstellung zu den Künstlerporträts der 20er, 30er Jahre, und ab übernächster Woche auch eine Neupräsentation im Bereich der zeitgenössischen Fotografie, die sich mit dem Thema, im weitesten Thema, mit dem Thema von Flüchtlingen, von Migration, von Verdrängung beschäftigen wird. Und jetzt freue ich mich sehr, Mischka Henner ans Pult zu bitten, und wünsche Ihnen viel Anregung an diesem Vortrag. Danke.
Did you tell them this will be in English? Did you tell everybody this will be in English? No, okay, I'm really sorry, everybody, but this I can't speak German, so I'm going to do the talk. I can speak French, but that would be strange, so I'll just speak in English, if that's okay. Thanks very much for coming out tonight. I know apparently there's a lot happening in Munich tonight, so I feel very honoured that you chose this talk to come to instead of many other things going on. I want to thank the museum and Inke especially for including me in that fantastic show upstairs. It's my first time I've come to Munich, first time I saw this museum, which was absolutely incredible. The collection that you have, the building, the spaces, I mean, I was blown away. And then the whole complex of museums as well is really, really extraordinary. I was blown away by it. So I'm going to talk tonight a little bit about where I came from, how I got to where I am now in terms of the work I'm making, a kind of introduction really to my approach, some ideas, whatever. I will start. We're going to be jumping from browser to browser. There's going to be some video, some sound, and some images, so just bear with me. It's not my computer, so as always, it's all a bit strange when you're working with someone else's machine. So first thing to state is that I didn't study art or photography. I studied sociology and cultural studies in the 90s in first at Loughborough University and then at Goldsmiths College in London. My grandparents were militant communists. My mother was involved in 68, the events of 68 in Paris, surrounded by Polish exiles. And I grew up in a kind of pretty heavy ideological kind of environment. So I studied, sociology came very naturally to me. And then of course, as soon as I left university, I wanted nothing to do with sociology or ideology, actually. I couldn't bear it anymore. I was very good at it. I was very good at theory, very good at writing. But it felt quite abstract to me. And it took a long time before I ended up in art and photography. So I was in my late 20s when I saw a show at the Tate Modern, which was Cruel and Tender, which was the work that really impressed me was New Topographics and the Dusseldorf School of Photography. So this kind of very neutral, kind of detached approach to a very non-emotional, a very non-expressive almost attitude towards making art. And I had no idea that such a thing could exist. For me, with my ignorance, I always thought art had to be expressive and had to be, you know, the writer or the poet or the painter pouring out their heart onto the canvas or onto the page. And I tried it And it was so bad, you know. It was, I'd show people the stuff I would write, and it would just, you know, I'd never see them again. I'd never speak to them again. And so when I saw this whole new approach to making, you know, to thinking about art and photography and so on, I felt like I found my language. And so I called up one of my friends who knew a lot of really creative people, and I asked her, do you know any photographers? I want to learn photography. I want to be a photographer. And I'm 27 at this point, but I was very excited. And she introduced me to Liz Locke, who's my partner. We just had our second baby. This is 12 years ago, by the way, but we just had our second baby. And so together, me and her, we would go out and explore the place where we lived, which was in Hackney in London, before it got taken over by the oligarchs. It was a very, you know, diverse, quite poor area, and we were living there in a squat. And we would go out with a Bronica camera, which was a medium format camera, which is exactly the camera I wanted to learn to use. It was, I don't know if you know about those cameras, but you look down at the camera, so you kind of plunge into the image, if you like. So you have the, you know, it's really difficult to figure out. If you want to go left, you don't, if you go left and look down, it doesn't go left, it goes right. It's a really different way of thinking about a different relationship to the world and photographing the world. And I really loved it. So I learned to use this camera, and together the two of us, we would go out and photograph people, the landscape, and we would choose the kind of, very much stylistically, we worked very similar to the work that inspired me in the first place. So we moved to London, we left London, moved to Manchester, and as soon as we got into Manchester, we started to make work in the areas surrounding Manchester, which again was, you know, very poor. It's where we were living, but, you know, very kind of post-industrial, you know, almost apocalyptic landscapes. But within them, you know, people just getting on with their lives. And so we would move from one group to another and get to know people and so on. So this is Stacey, who was pregnant, and we would kind of set up these formal portraits, you know, try to say something about the place and about the time. This is 8 years ago. So Oldham, which was a town very close to where we lived, was a classic post-industrial town, made famous for its cotton industry, but since, you know, as you can see by, with the mill in the background there, just completely decimated. A really high Muslim population, which was very segregated from the white population. There were race riots in Oldham a couple of years before this picture. So it's a very tense area, but this is the place where we lived. And this is housing awaiting demolition, classic kind of English terraced housing, but there's still families living on the house on the furthest to the left. And then as I was working with photography, I was kind of, I was starting to get quite frustrated with it, actually. I started to get frustrated with the camera, in a sense, holding the camera and being in the world with a camera. There was something about it that didn't seem right to me. I felt quite uncomfortable about it. It seemed to impede in a way, or to get in the way of relationships. And so I started to experiment quite loosely. So I would take photographs. I would try to take formal portraits of people without them knowing, if you like, you know, because the formal portrait convention is quite sort of rigid. And I was wondering, well, can you apply that in a kind of hidden way, if you like? And then, you know, I would do it with groups as well. So this is Oldham's first gay pride parade. Obviously, that's not the parade. People watching the parade, but that clash, that collision, and choosing to look the other way, already I could see that it was really, you know, it allowed you to see things that the more cliched image making might miss. But as I said, I mean, I grew quite frustrated with this approach. I mean, we worked for 6 years as documentary photographers in that way with cameras, and I was starting to kind of revisit one of my favorite writers, who was Jean Baudrillard. And there was one line in particular from his book Cool Memories, which is, one dreams of a stealthy idea which would slip through all the detection systems without being spotted and unfailingly reach its target. And at the same time, I was reading a lot about conceptual art and about contemporary art. And the thing that struck me is that art, really, even contemporary art and conceptual art, were a form of documentary. I never saw that much of a distinction between the two. You know, when you look at art made in the 60s, at conceptual art, I feel that it really says something about the time. And also, obviously, the more you find out about the work, the more you find artists rooted in conceptual art who really wanted to try and find a language that was appropriate to the time they were living in. So if it's Sol LeWitt or Hans Hacker, for example, you know, I mean, these are the kind of artists that I really started to appreciate and felt I could learn a lot from and maybe apply some of their ideas to documentary. I'll revisit that in a moment. But yeah, this idea of conceptual art as being something that contained this stealthy idea, in a sense, that Baudrillard talked about, was very exciting to me, and it made me shift direction completely in my practice and literally put the camera down. So the one of the things that I noticed was that myself and many of the photographers I knew, and everyone basically that I was surrounded by, spent so much of their time looking at screens, right? So this is still 2009. The internet was kind of, you know, it wasn't what it is today, but it was already rapidly developing. And there were mobile phones, of course. And the screen as an interface to the world was something that was, you know, absolutely, well, it was an everyday thing. I mean, people didn't even think about it. And it struck me that as a medium, I must make work about the screen, because that is my primary interaction with the world, and not only mine, but society's, it seemed. So one of the first things I did was, a lot of the work I started initially was done with humor, if you like. So one of the things, one of the first projects that I did, it was in 2010, was Bliss. And I don't know if you remember, but in 2010, the world seemed to be coming to an end. Can you imagine compared to now? But back in 2010, there was the financial crisis that hit. There were some terrible natural disasters. And the people who would be telling us all about this stuff seemed to not have a clue about what was going on. And no, I'm talking here about the news presenters, the experts that would be on television. So what I would do is I would kind of put them to sleep. So this is an American channel, CBS, I think, Face the Nation, and this is an expert talking. And what I would do is I would just take a still of when he seemed like he was basically asleep or dreaming or something like that. And it felt like a very light gesture, but quite a profound one in a way, that just by pressing spacebar on YouTube at the right moment, you could, you know, and taking a screenshot, you could say something about the state of the news. Now, it's a bit worrying now because, you know, it's 2016 and mainstream politicians are talking like this, saying that these news presenters and experts don't know anything. So for me, that's put me in a difficult position because at the time, you know, we still had a lot of faith in these experts and news readers, news presenters, but now it seems we don't have any. So anyway, so I would have quite a lot of fun with this, and then I would translate those into light boxes. And I guess this was, you know, a lot of the work that I was doing existed really only on the internet and in books that were printed on demand. So I would work very quickly, I would have an idea, I would make a book, and then get on with the next thing. And I don't know if you know print on demand, but it allows you to basically get one book published or printed at a time. It can be a colour book, it could be hardback. But instead of traditional publishing, which, you know, you'd have to make at least 500 or 1,000 copies of a book to make it economically viable, with print on demand, you can get a single one made for like 20 euros or something. So it allowed somebody like myself to work very quickly, to have an idea, publish it, move on to the next one. And it was... So I was so productive initially that I was invited to exhibit straight away, and I had a real problem at first. This is 6 years ago, but I really had difficulties figuring out how to translate work that came from the internet that I'd put into books into kind of installations in museums and galleries. It was a very, like I said, I didn't have any training in it. I had no experience in it. I had to learn very quickly. And yeah, but this is an example with the Bliss light boxes. So whilst I'm making this work, I'm thinking, I'm having a kind of crisis, excuse me, about photography. And really wondering what, you know, what is photography and why are the voices that we turn to find, to figure out what photography is and what it might be, and what it might mean, seem so limited. So I got quite frustrated about the discourse about photography being restricted in so few hands. And there was a very easy way to kind of explore that further, and that was just to type in photography is in Google. I mean, I'm not going to lie. It's a very simple gesture, photography is. And 6 years ago, there were 3 million phrases that came back. So photography is the most fantastic art form, let's say, right? Or photography is, and then lots of scientific definitions as well. But anyway, basically what I did is I compiled all of them, about 3,500. I mean, I figured out 3,500 out of 3.5 million is probably a good place to stop, because you could just keep going. I made a book printed on demand. And so, like a photograph crops all of the detail, all of the surrounding detail out from a place, I did the same with literature. So I would crop out everything that came before the words photography is. So photography is understood as a medium with no fixed identity. Photography is closed on Wednesdays. Photography is a simple method that documents changes that occur over time. And then some much more complex scientific descriptions. And basically, the search engine made no discrimination, really, as to where it would receive its data. So the phrases could come from a 14-year-old writing a blog on photography. It could come from a Nikon press release. It could come from a scientific journal. And so what you're left with is this vast kind of terrain of definitions of what photography might be. And I found that really interesting, actually. So let me just skip through. Page 9 is quite interesting. Photography is inspirational and propagandist. Photography is the means, not the end. Photography is the marvelous, anonymous folk art of our time. Photography is most forcible and effective when it is truest to itself. Photography is excellent and the flow of images is expressive beyond words. I mean, obviously, you know, some of these are meaningless and others are quite profound, I think. But it's that collection of information that I found really interesting. Right, so let me move on. Now, obviously, as I'm spending time with the screen and spending time with the internet, it's impossible to not start to think about the possibilities for making work with those things. Not least, the ability to make work about things that are far away, or things that are huge, vast, much more difficult to capture if you're on your own trying to capture them in the real world. So I'll give you an example. I mean, 51 US Military Outposts is one of the first projects that I did working in this way. And it's a project that if I was to do on my own as a photographer, it would take me years and cost, you know, probably hundreds of thousands of pounds to produce. But what I'm able to do suddenly by learning to negotiate my way through the internet and through this ocean of data, I'm able, if I have a really clear thing that I'm looking for, I'm able to produce something like this. So basically, it was an homage to Ed Ruscha's early artist books, 26 gasoline stations, 34 parking lots. And a friend of mine said, you know, I'm putting a show together of work inspired by Ruscha. Have you got any ideas? And I thought, when I went away and thought, well, maybe I'll do this, 51 US military outposts. So it's a collection of 51 US military outposts in 51 different countries around the world. And I found them, most of them, two-thirds of them are easy to find. You could just go on the US Army website and it literally just catalogues where the bases are. Or you can download the Department of Defense research and procurement documents and you can see which bases are receiving which hardware and all of that stuff. But the other third were much more covert and much harder to find, and I had to rely on different kinds of information leaks that the internet provides. So this is a really contentious site in the middle of the Indian Ocean. This is Camp Justice, Diego Garcia. So this is a site that has been used for rendition flights when they will kind of kidnap detainees and transport them around the world, on the other side of the world. And it's a British territory, but used by American military. This is the 821st Air Base Group in Thule Air Base in Greenland. And I can show you, this is the map that I would make as I was doing the research and identifying these locations. And the imagery itself, the satellite imagery, is very kind of dull, really. Satellite imagery generally isn't very interesting because it's not produced for an aesthetic purpose, really. It's produced for, you know, an informational or navigational or infrastructural purpose. And that aspect really interested me about it, the fact that, you know, the image was secondary to the content. So you can see here the way in which a really thorough research process, negotiating lots of different types of data, can take you all around the world, in a sense. Let me just go back to this. So this is Menwith Hill. It's a signals intelligence base run by the US military in the middle of the British countryside, a very secret base. And I also loved the fact that I was using, in a way, military hardware, satellite, and internet technology that had been developed for military purposes to turn the gaze back towards the military kind of superstructure. I found that, as an act and as an outcome, I found that really interesting. And this is an installation, again, this is one way in which I translated the work into a gallery space. So there are 51 plinths here that you move around the space. So in a sense, and there's a map behind where the photograph was taken, which shows the grid with the reference points of each base in the space. And this is the budget option. This is if museums don't have much money. This is a much simpler way to exhibit the work. So these are 51 cards on shelves that show each of the locations. And I also made a portfolio of the work. So there's 51 prints in the portfolio. And I designed the box to echo the kind of the military hardware in terms of design. I like the idea, the possibility that in a way this is a sort of weapon. The artist's book is a weapon of some sort, or the artist's work. I mean, obviously it's not. It's a different type of weapon, clearly. But so this is a map that comes in the box that outlines the locations. Now, as I was working on this, I was kind of amazed, and many people have been amazed, that none of the bases were censored, right? That the censorship didn't seem to really apply to US military bases. And it surprised me too. And I started to research it, and I found I came across something quite unusual, which was that when Google Earth was introduced in 2005, so this is 4 years after 9/11, the one country that kind of panicked and freaked out and censored hundreds of locations around their country was the Dutch. The Dutch in Holland. And not only that, but the way that they censored their landscapes was using one of the most spectacular Photoshop effects, which is called crystallize. So what it does is, what the crystallize effect does is it turns any photographic detail into it just reduces the detail into bold, colorful polygons. And in Russia, for example, they use different types of censorship depending on the landscape. So they might blur it, they might just have a white square, they might pixelate it. But the Dutch were absolutely consistent with their choice of censorship. Now, I'm speaking to a German audience who I assume you're all very, for you, blurring. Look, going on Google Street View and seeing everything blurred must be quite normal to you. But in England, there's very little blurring apart from faces. So anyway, for me to come across this, I found it really spectacular. But not only that, but I loved the collision of the kind of digital and the analog, if you like, the digital intervention of a Photoshop filter and the analog-esque aesthetic of the terrain as it appeared to the satellite's cameras. This is a NATO storage annex. So I was able to find all of these locations in Holland. I'll give you a live demonstration, actually. We're in Google Earth. And then if we go in here, this is a town called Nordwijk-on-Zee, and you can see there the painting that has been made. I like to think that, so I've not invented this. I mean, you know, people think that this is something I've done. But I mean, somebody else asked, I got an email from somebody who was really curious as to who the architect was, if I could tell them who the architect of all these buildings were. I had to explain, it's not an architect. The other thing that I found really interesting about this being in Holland is that Holland, of course, most of the landscape is designed to protect its people from a natural threat, right, which is flooding. So every square inch of Holland is built in a way and designed to protect them from flooding. And yet here, in the internet environment, we have a similar construction which is built to protect them from a human threat. So again, I found it really interesting that the Dutch, of all people, should choose this. And then, of course, in an age where we're surrounded by cameras, where cameras are everywhere, where imagery is being produced constantly, even the act of censorship is completely absurd, because I can just take this guy and, you know, we can just get straight in there and have a look around. And you know, of course, that there is definitely something here that we shouldn't be looking at, because otherwise, why would they hide it? So all of those contradictions, and also I guess the idea that, you know, maybe the intelligence services weren't that literate, or thought that we as a public weren't so literate when it came to looking at satellite images, for example, that we might see this and think, oh, you know, there's nothing there. That just looks normal, because we don't know how to read satellite imagery. So I found that kind of inconsistency and contradiction really rich material to work with. in the midst of making all of this work, it made me think a lot about documentary photography and where, you know, because I felt that what I was doing was, in a sense, a form of documentary photography fit for the geospatial age, if you like. So it was a really clear development for me from the work of, say, Robert Adams and Lewis Bolt and all of those guys, and even Gursky and Ruff. I'm thinking of his more documentary work. To me, it seemed like a really clear development to go from that to working with satellite imagery. It seemed like an obvious thing to do. But in the age of digital memory, or the lack of memory, it also made me think about what did it mean for the old work. And obviously, the idea of erasure and the idea of memory loss, when applied to images and image making, leads to a different way of thinking about it. And I guess I wanted to do something with it. And one of the most seminal books of documentary photography is The Americans by Robert Frank. And it seemed, I was teaching at a college in Manchester, and the students didn't turn up on one particular day, and I had a copy of The Americans, and I scanned it. I did a really high resolution scan. And while I was waiting for the students to turn up, I just started to erase the detail. And I did it for a while. And then as I zoomed back out, I saw this kind of image. And I thought, my God, this is quite interesting, because the ghost of the original is present, but this is a completely new image. And I felt that if I was going to do this, I would need to do the entire book. So I had to apply the same method to all 83 images. And so what I'm doing here is I'm making a really high res scan, and then I'm kind of diving into the image, and I'm not coming back out again until I've finished erasing. So I don't know really what I'm getting until I finish with the image. So I'm kind of looking at the image almost, I'm seeing the printing dots, literally. And this idea of kind of plunging into the image, diving into an image as a source material for work, was something that I felt needed to be done. So, in a way, and my view about this work has changed over time. This was done 4 years ago now. I've come to see it as an erosion of America as much as anything else, as well as a kind of meditation on photography in the digital age. And then this is a portfolio that the prints, so the digital silver gelatin prints that I made from the digital files. And I'm going to start talk a little bit now about No Man's Land, which is the project that's on view here in a beautiful installation upstairs. No Man's Land, again, similar idea, similar process in terms of thinking of what can be made using the internet and existing cameras that are out there. And my partner at the time was working with prostitutes and sex workers in Manchester, and she was getting to know them really well. And as a photographer, she was really struggling to figure out how to photograph them. A photograph, a portrait, is so inadequate in giving any information about anything, really, that she really struggled. And at the end of her project, I suggested that she maybe does something on the places where the women worked. And so she was going to go and photograph the locations where they worked. And I just typed in an address we knew where the women worked behind the train station. And I went on Google Street View. And sure enough, I found one of the women that we're pretty certain it's her. She's a lady called Sandra. She's no longer here anymore. But this is 8 years ago. And when I saw this image on my screen, I was really taken aback, actually. I was really struck by a number of things. First of all, the composition of the image, the fact that the human figure in Street View is always distant. The camera position is always elevated. The algorithm that was developed by Google that blurs human faces, which came out actually as a result of data protection legal challenge in Germany. So Google had to develop an algorithm. So the combination of all those elements, for me, made an image that was really, really fascinating and unlike anything I'd seen before. And as a result of this image, I started to look into, I started finding forums on the internet where men would share information on where they could find prostitutes. So a bit like Airbnb, right? Or I'm trying to think. I know it's very distasteful, but that's what I found. So you know, the men would share locations. They would review the women's performances. You know, they would give them star ratings. They would say, you know, how much it cost, and they would share the locations on where they could find them. And I'm not joking. There are thousands and thousands of these locations that are shared amongst men across the world. And so this kind of collision between the strength of the material, the kind of completely dystopian aspect of everything happening, and the images themselves, I worked on this quite obsessively for about, for 2 years. And as I did, I was drawn most to the Mediterranean landscapes. So locations in Italy and Spain that were in the middle of nowhere generally, so in between towns and cities. And I would kind of corroborate, I would also find the locations based on maps that were included in European Union research reports that were made online, put online, that were about sex trafficking and sex workers and so on. So again, I would kind of connect all of these dots and then go to these locations in Street View and sure enough find these roads in the middle of nowhere populated by these young women, migrant women. It's difficult to know exactly for sure who they were. But there was something about it that seemed very powerful to me. So again, I gathered all of this material and I printed a book on demand called No Man's Land. And it caused a big, a bit of a scandal. It was, I had a lot of problems with it actually, like in terms of attacks and so on. And then eventually the art critics started getting involved and thought it was a very important work, and it started to get nominated for awards and things and put into exhibitions. And it wasn't a good experience, actually, I'll be honest with you, the whole project. But I felt it was something very urgent to do, and I felt that I needed to make something with this, because like I said, the combination of elements seemed to only be possible at this moment, not before, not since. So, yeah. Well, there's plenty to talk about with that one, but I'm sure we will. Now, I turned my gaze back to America for the next project, which was, again, trying to figure out a way to visualize infrastructure, if you like, to try and find a way to use the existing technology that we had access to talk about and to show huge things that were much too big to photograph, if you like. And it seemed like the satellites, from their really high vantage point, were able to represent things that from the ground were impossible to see, and often even from a plane are very difficult to see. So I turned my attention to oil fields in the US. And there was something about the oil fields also that fascinated me, the infrastructure, the systems, the networks of pipes and pump jacks. So these here are pump jacks. They're the shadows of pump jacks. Those are we call them nodding donkeys in England. They're the things that suck the oil out of the ground. In fact, some of them suck the oil out of the ground and others pump carbon dioxide into the ground. And the carbon dioxide pushes the oil towards the pump jack sucking the oil out. So this is a huge image. It's about 6 meters by 2.5 meters. This is a detail close up. this is another one, a neighboring oil field. And whilst I was researching this, I mean, the thing is that the image itself is quite striking, but in itself, I'm left kind of unmoved by the image when I was making the work. The thing that really struck me was the kind of the data layers that now sit, that surround us now. You know, there are data layers that we can't see that are under our feet, that are in the air. You know, there's data being transmitted all around and so on. And I came across this here, which is called a GIS database. So GIS is Geographic Information System. It's used by, you know, organizations, commercial organizations and so on. In this case, the GIS data is all about the oil infrastructure. So if we go to the Levelland in Texas, we'll see here, this is the landscape, which in itself resembles a circuit board for me. But what we can see if we go into it, with this database, it took me a year to find this. But when I found it, I felt like I'd reached the Holy Grail. I'd found the Holy Grail. Because what this tells me is it tells me what every single pump jack in the landscape is. Every pump jack has its own name, right? Its own unique identifying number. That's an old pump jack. That's not the best example. But if we choose this one, say, I can identify the well. So I can, here, so if I can click on this, this data contains a huge amount of information about that individual well, how far down it goes, who owns it, how long it's been in operation. These links link to permits that all the oil companies have to fill out. They're 150-page permit applications that detail an enormous amount of data. And so combining that, I mean, figuring out a way, in the end, I chose to actually leave that information out. But for me, it gave me permission, in a sense, to feel like I could actually produce these images. So because there was an underlying kind of material about them that to me gave them some weight. So this is another oil field in Galveston Bay in Texas. And this is one of the most dramatic ones. This is a town in Yoakum County. And it's a town that was born from the oil boom and has been kind of consumed by oil. So every one of those white squares is a pump jack. So you can see the pump jacks in the schoolyard, in the playground, in the park, in the by the football stadium, all around the airport. yeah, really strong image. And this is in Kern County in California, an oil field, that, again, where there isn't a square inch of the land that hasn't been ripped apart or ripped open in order to try and find oil. And this is another example of, this is the one of those images, huge. They come in different sizes, but obviously they're a combination. Each image is a combination of hundreds of screenshots. So you're able to get an image of incredible detail by stitching hundreds of them together. And this is from a show that I had in Switzerland recently. This is Northward Estate Oil Field. And it's the first time I presented the work like this. This is a structure, like a mausoleum type structure. We're talking about it. We may be exhibiting it in Arles this summer, but it's a 13-meter long print. It's a single print, so it's combining the satellite imagery with the inkjet printing technology, and it's a single image of an oil field. It's an image that's impossible to see in its entirety in the physical space, which for me is a really interesting metaphor for the internet. And then this is a series I did called 18 Pump Jacks, which is from all of the material that I found in oil fields around the US, the individual pump jacks in lots and lots of different locations, you get a sense of the landscapes that the oil industry has colonized. So that the pump jacks are in agricultural land where food is being produced, where fruit and vegetables are being produced. I mean, the industry makes no discrimination as to where to put its pump jacks. And in England, we're seeing that now as well. That's starting to happen more and more. And then this is the grid. This is how we present those prints. Now, as I was researching the oil fields, I kept coming across these very strange structures, and I had no idea what I was looking at. I accidentally came across what are called feedlots. Now, these are gigantic animal farming operations. So 97% of all beef consumed in the US goes through a feedlot. So traditionally, a farmer would need 5 years for a cow to reach its full mature weight. These feedlots accelerate that to 18 months. So in 18 months, by feeding cows growth hormones, antibiotics, and corn, the cow kind of reaches its full mature weight very quickly. And what you're seeing here is a kind of superstructure, super farming structure. So you can see the individual cows there. So each dot is a cow. And then this is the giant toilet, basically. There are 60,000 cows in this farm in particular. And the chemicals used to break down the waste, the animal waste, in this case, turns the landscape, the liquid, the waste red. In others, it's green. So this is another such location. This is Tascosa Feed Yard in Texas. Now, I made this series and it went viral on the internet. It caused a big sensation. I knew when I came across it that I certainly had never seen images like these before. And to me, it stood as a really, really great metaphor for our own relationship to food, especially industrially produced food, because we can't see it. We don't know where it's coming from. We don't know what's in it. And these farms don't look like farms. They look like, well, Rem Koolhaas, actually, the architect, he uses this series a lot because he talks about the new kind of architecture needing to, you know, replicate or be fit for the systems and networks that are in place in society. And he considers this to be an example of such a thing where the structure of the farm itself is absolutely connected to the systems and networks of production and consumption of food. So this series went viral, and a journalist from Texas called me up, a Reuters journalist, and said, "Have you had any contact with lawyers in the US?" And I said, "No, not at all. Why should I?" And she explained that in America, the beef industry is so powerful that they enacted laws that made the photographing of feedlots illegal. So there were cases of photographers going to court because they were caught photographing. They were caught photographing feedlots. Now, the beef industry is so frightened of consumers knowing how the food is produced, how the beef is produced, that they don't want any images of them. And they went as far as to lobby lawmakers to make laws that made it illegal to photograph them. And yet nobody thought to look on Google Earth, right? Which is all I did, really. And so, you know, this is a story that kind of caused a big stir in the US. There isn't a week that goes by where I'm not asked to send images for some campaign or whatever. And most recently, actually, just yesterday, the German Ministry of Agriculture want to publish these in a booklet that they're making, which I didn't expect. And then, of course, you know, this is a when work goes viral, it kind of goes completely out of your control. I mean, work is out of your control anyway. But on the internet, it's really amazing what happens. So this is Meatpacking Journal, right? So this is a journal in America, a magazine, very glossy magazine, dedicated to the meat industry. So if you work in a slaughterhouse, you need equipment or tools or whatever, then you know you get a subscription to Meatpacking Journal. And I got an email from them saying, hey, we love your work. Can we feature it in our magazine? And I guess I love the ambiguity of the work that, you know, I don't think of myself as a political activist, really. So I just love to see the different ways in which the work is interpreted and so on. I mean, they didn't pay me for it, but they said to me, look, we can't pay you, but you can put an advert in the magazine for you. We'll give you a full page advert. And I said, really? Okay, well, so I wondered what I could do. And I decided to advertise the print. So I make a small print, and I, you know, Meatpacking Journal is pretty brutal. I mean, it's like, you know, and I thought I'd portion control, you know, and I thought I would give them the sanctity and the peace of a museum wall on the back page of their magazine, and present the information like it was a museum label. I didn't sell any prints from that. Nobody from who reads Meatpacking magazine bought it. And then Art Forum featured because Ram Koolhaas was writing an article like I was describing, and he really wanted to use one of the images from the series. And so I got a call from Art Forum. I didn't know that it would be on the cover, but when my gallerist in New York called me and said, why the hell didn't you tell me that your work was on the cover of Art Forum? I had no idea. But for me, I was blown away, because for me, the art market is a kind of meat market. It's just another kind of extension of, you know, production, consumption, commodities, trading, and so on. And so I loved that. I'm really proud that I made something that sits as comfortably in Meatpacking magazine, Meatpacking Journal, as it does on the cover of Art Forum. I'll come back to, I'm not the only one. I'm not long to go now, only couple more projects to show you, and then we're done. This is, this is new work that I've been working on. I made some work a year or two ago on the back of a grant, a scientific grant, looking at vision. Now, my vision is actually I've got terrible vision. My eyesight is appalling. And as part of the project, I got my eyes completely tested, and I learned a lot about the eyes, about how the eye works, about the relationship between the eye and the brain, and so on. And the neural connections and systems and networks of the eye are really fascinating. And there are ways to know, I'm sure you know, that there are ways to track how one sees and how one looks at things. And actually, there's a very strong commercial application for this technology. So advertisers love to know which part of the advert you're looking at. So, you know, they do a lot of focus groups and so on, where they get people to wear these devices, or they have these devices that record how one looks at things. And it struck me that there was potentially a really rich source of material to be made that's not at all looking at the commercial applications of it, but to think about how images, what images mean, and what our relationship to images are, and how we look at images. So this is one of the first things that I did, which is to look at a portrait of the Queen. So I don't know if you know, but in England, all British citizens are subjects of the Queen. We are the Queen's subjects. But the bizarre kind of contradiction is that the Queen's status relies on us, kind of her being present to us constantly. So she's on coins, she's on stamps, you know, her image is everywhere. So here you have a person whose identity really is a product of our gaze, you know, our constant looking at her. So what I did here is I looked at the same picture of the Queen for about 100 seconds or so, and this is 6-second segments each time of of looking at that same that single picture. So the dots represent where the eye rested on the image. And what I've done is it's a Perspex mask. It's an acrylic mask that sits in front of the image. So the actual portrait of the Queen sits behind the acrylic. So the acrylic hides the overall image. And the viewer is only able to see what this viewer saw. And so what you have here is a combination of all of these elements, which the longer you look at, you kind of construct, I think of it in this way, you kind of construct an image, a final image, if you like. This is work in progress, so I haven't really figured out a way to talk about it properly. This is looking at an Ellsworth Kelly Red Blue Untitled. So again, the actual work is hidden. The eye never looks at the same place in the same at the same thing in the same way. It's impossible. The eye is constantly moving. It's actually very difficult to control your eyes, believe it or not. The more you get into this into it, the crazier it gets. But the eye is kind of out of control, really. It's kind of looking and searching constantly. Even if you try and... It's impossible to keep the eye still. And so the implications of that for how one looks at art, and I guess what art is once... I mean, it's a very post-structural idea, isn't it, that the death of the author, and I guess this, in a way, is the birth of the viewer, that the viewer makes the work here, if you like. And I quite like the direct translation of that, that what you actually see isn't the work of art, you're seeing how someone looked at the work of art, which becomes art. I mean, I don't know if it works, but I'm really, I love the method and the outcome so far. And how are we doing for time? We're okay, we've got time for 4 more minutes. Okay, so I'll just end on a video piece, which is about 4 minutes long. There it is. So I recommend you try to watch all the way to the end and see if you can figure out what's happening here. Thanks very much, and I look forward to your questions and the discussion. If we could dim the lights, please. Is there a way to dim the lights? The lights, can we cut the lights? Maybe I'll just start. Oh, that's it? Okay, we'll just play then.
thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed. I kind of messed up on some parts. But thanks for watching. Like, even if it was horrible, and like, even if it was bad, I don't care. Comment what you thought, and subscribe. Thanks.